the audit and conclusion. So coming to the prophylaxis, antimicrobial prophylaxis. So there can be two or three types of prophylaxis. The primary prophylaxis, where we prevent the occurrence of the infection. The secondary, which is prevent the recurrence of the infection, and eradication, that is elimination of the colonized bacteria. So antimicrobial prophylaxis talks of the primary prophylaxis, that is prevention of the occurrence of infection. It is defined as the brief course of antibiotic or antimicrobial agent which is initiated just before the operation begins, and it is critically timed to reduce the microbial burden to a level that the patient or the person can defend, so that the host defenses are not overwhelmed by the infection. And what we are worried about in giving antimicrobial prophylaxis is what we are targeting is surgical site infection. It is defined as infection in the operative field, which is following a surgical intervention within 30 days. And if an implantation or a prosthesis is applied, then within 90 days. So what are the indications of prophylactic antibiotics? The most important is in a case of clean contaminated surgery to prevent SSI, that is surgical site infection. We have class 1 evidence against this, that we should give AMP in clean contaminated surgery. Another indication is clean surgery with insertion of artificial devices or prosthetic material. Again, class 1 evidence is available that we should use AMP in all these cases. The third is in the patients where the infection will be catastrophic for the patient, like when the organs like brain is involved, like in neurosurgery, in open heart surgery, in ophthalmic surgery, where there will be risk to the vision of the patient, and transplant surgery where graft losses are common if the infection occurs. The other indications in clean surgeries will be a patient with poor nutrition, a patient with morbid obesity, a patient with poorly controlled diabetes, and any other cause which is leading to immunosuppression, including immunosuppressive drugs. Then what goals we are trying to achieve by antibiotic prophylaxis? The first and foremost is reducing incidence of SSI, which I am talking about from last 4 slides. Then reducing, thus this will also reduce, add to the reduction in morbidity, hospital stay, and the cost of healthcare. The minimization of the patient's normal flora. By giving antibiotics, we don't want to disturb the normal flora of the patient, especially the GI flora and the oral flora. Then next will be minimizing the adverse effects of the antibiotics. So I will be talking about the goals, and I will be talking about this in the goals and principles, and minimize the emergence of antibiotic resistance, which is most important. So the most important part of this presentation will be the principles of antimicrobial prophylaxis, which I will be discussing on these 5 headings: the risk factors to SSI, the common pathogens and the choice of agent which should be judicious, and dose and timing of the drug administration, the duration of therapy, and the route of administration. So coming to the risk factors of SSI. In clean and clean contaminated wounds, the risk of infection varies from 2 to 5%. While in contaminated wounds, it varies from 6 to 15%. And in dirty wounds, dirty surgical wounds, it goes up to around 25%. So talking a bit on the classification of this wound, is clean wounds are where the only skin and subcutaneous tissue is involved, and where there is no entrance into any of the GI, respiratory, or urinary tract. Even cardiovascular surgeries and breast surgeries, orthopedic surgeries, they are clean surgeries. In clean contaminated surgeries, we invade into the respiratory tract or the GI tract or the urinary tract with minor spillage. The contaminated wounds include clean contaminated surgeries with gross spillage, while dirty wounds are long-lasting infected wounds like fecal peritonitis or old trauma wounds, etc., etc. Another risk for SSI will be insertion of prosthesis or implant. Why it is important? Because even lower oculum or inoculum of bacteria can cause colonization in such implants. So AMP becomes important when, even in clean wounds, when prosthesis or implant is in the context. Then the duration of surgery, which is always an additional risk to the surgical site infection, because it is duration of surgery merges with, you know, the increased blood transfusion, increased blood loss, the patient going into compromised immune status. Other risk factors for SSI will be comorbidities like American Society of Anesthesiology grade 2 or above are more prone to develop SSI in their post-operative course. So we should be judicious in the use of antibiotics. First, we should assess the patient's risk of SSI, which we have already discussed. Then we should acquire the knowledge about common local pathogens. And we should... we should acquire knowledge about the common local pathogens and the microbiologic trends, which are very important. The resistance patterns of the particular hospital or the particular region. The allergy, the history of allergy to particular antibiotics to the patient. And the active, we should use a narrow spectrum antibiotic so that we target the pathogen which is more likely to contaminate the surgical site. Now, these are the common pathogens which we would come across when we are dealing with a skin wound. Like it will be mostly contaminated by Staph aureus or beta hemolytic streptococci, which are mostly sensitive to penicillins, macrolides, and clindamycin. The head and neck surgery, in addition to the Staph aureus and beta hemolytic streptococci, there can be oral anaerobes. So 95% of them are sensitive to metronidazole. Then below waist surgeries, like in perineum or in the perianal region, there can be contamination, additional contamination with anaerobes and E. coli, which are mostly sensitive to metronidazole and second generation cephalosporin or gentamicin respectively. The in cases of prosthesis, again coagulase negative Staph aureus and coagulase negative staphylococci and Staph aureus are common pathogens. 90% of them are 90% of coagulase negative bacteria are sensitive to the common ampicillin, clindamycin and macrolides. But in cases of prosthesis, in nowadays with the Staph aureus which is coming up or which is colonizing those prostheses, half of them are methylene resistant, so they require higher antibiotics. Now, what are the choices of antibiotics which we have or which is proposed by CDC to for these various surgeries? For vascular surgeries, because vascular and orthopedic surgeries, because most common pathogen is Staph aureus or Staph epidermidis, the common antibiotics which are proposed are cefazolin and vancomycin in cases of MRSA proven center or patients, which I will talk about later on when to use vancomycin, or the patient has allergy to beta lactams. Then in upper GI, because the enterobacteriaceae is the most common infestant, so cefazolin is proposed and metronidazole can be added if there is severe contamination. In cases of biliary and small bowel surgeries, again enterobacteriaceae with enterococci are the most common with additional bacteroids if small bowel is there. So cefazolin or cefuroxime is the proposed antibiotic. If there is distal small bowel surgeries, then metronidazole can be added. Then appendix and colorectal, again enterobacteriaceae and bacteroids. So most of them have a high load of anaerobic infestation. So we use cephalosporins with good anaerobic cover, like cefoxitin or cefotetan, or we use a cefazolin with metronidazole in addition to oral preparation, which is given at various centers for oral preoperative oral preparation in colorectal cases. But we have the data on oral preparation, oral decontamination is not very, very clear whether we should give or we should not. Then coming to common pathogen microbiology trends, we should be aware about the microbiology trends in the present. Most of the SSI which is caused by gram-positive cocci, and that is, and out of that, most common is Staph aureus. 22% of all SSIs is caused by Staph aureus. Earlier in 1970s, 1980s, it was gram-negative bacteria which used to be the most important pathogen in surgical site infection. But over the last two decades, it has decreased from 50% to around 30%. And because of inadvertent use of various antibiotics, the resistant organisms are growing up. The MRSA, which was around 16% of the total gram-positive infestations or severe SSIs, has increased to 20% of all severe SSIs over the last 5 to 10 years. And 5% of all infections are caused by anaerobic bacteria, which is more common in colorectal cases. So overall, for all clean wounds, this is the general concept that first and second generation cephalosporins are preferred for most of these surgical procedures which are clean. And for for clean contaminated wounds, the second generation cephalosporin with anti-anaerobic activity can be used, or a first generation cephalosporin with metronidazole can be used. And patients with allergies to the beta-lactams, either vancomycin or clindamycin can be used. If gram-positive cover is to be given, if gram-negative cover is to be desired, then aminoglycosides or fluoroquinolones are used. Now coming to some specific antibiotic use like vancomycin. Vancomycin, as I already stated that it is used in cases of beta-lactam sensitivity or in a patient with MRSA proven infestation. So it is not, and it is not routinely indicated as a prophylactic agent. It is the various indications which are listed in CDC guidelines is cluster of surgical site infections due to MRSA or staph epidermidis detected at an institution or patient who is known to be colonized with MRSA. So such patients who have high risk of MRSA are patients who have prolonged hospitalization or the nursing staffs or residents who work in and out day and night in the hospital, or the patients who are on prolonged ventilation or hemodialysis. Whenever we use vancomycin, it should be a single dose. The dose should not be repeated because the T-half of vancomycin is 4 to 6 hours. So it need not be repeated during the surgery. And in patients who have methylene-sensitive staph aureus, in those cases, vancomycin should never be used because it is always less effective than cefazolin. Now, few words on nasal decolonization, which is where we use intranasal mupirocin. So, universal screening protocol has been advocated by various authors, but it has not been accepted in all the guidelines. So, universal screening is not suggested. The epidemiology of nasal contamination is around 30% of the general population is contaminated, has a nasal staph aureus contamination. And out of that, 1% is MRSA. But all of these don't translate into SSIs. So there are various studies which talk about whether we should do nasal decolonization or not. There was a RCT on around 3,800 neurosurgery patients where they found that there was no difference in overall rate of SSI when we used intranasal mupirocin in addition to the antimicrobial prophylaxis. But definitely there was decrease in SSI in patients who were carriers for nasal staph aureus. Then there was RCT on orthopedics and CVS patients, which also suggested that there was significantly less deep surgical site infection. There was no difference among superficial surgical site infection when intranasal mupirocin was added to the general prophylaxis. Then another RCT on general surgery, there was no difference in SSIs in among the groups where we use intranasal mupirocin or we do not. So the present recommendation which has come, which is already 10 years old but is still carried over, is that in patients who are carriers for nasal staph aureus, the intranasal mupirocin should be added when they are undergoing a cardiac surgery or an orthopedic surgery, especially when the implantation is carried out, like we are doing some plating or nailing, or we are doing knee implantation or something. Then what about allergy to beta-lactam antibiotics? The patients who are allergic to beta-lactam antimicrobials, then like if they are allergic to penicillin, then they are likely to be allergic to cephalosporins as well as imipenems. But the thing is that we do not always diagnose the allergy as we have to document it as a true type 1 IgE mediated infection, which is very uncommon. Which is manifested in the form of generalized urticaria, bronchospasm, and symptoms of exfoliative dermatitis. So if these symptoms are there, then the other antibiotics like cephalosporins and carbapenems should never be used. But if these symptoms are not there, there is just a localized urticaria to penicillin, then cephalosporins can be safely used in these patients. So we have to discriminate between IgE-mediated true type of allergic reaction to a simple urticaria. And it is very important to bring it out in the history that the patient, if he has received the penicillin in the past, so he will definitely tell you that there was this kind of reaction. So you have to find out from the history whether it was true allergic reaction or not. And typical symptoms always come after 30 to 60 minutes. If the symptoms appear within 5 to 10 minutes, then they are not true IgE mediated. Either you document it on history or you prove it by serum tests. So in that case, vancomycin or clindamycin is appropriate for clean procedures. And for a gram-negative cover, we can go for antibiotics like fluoroquinolones and aminoglycosides. Now coming to the dose, which is more important. It should be sufficient enough to achieve adequate tissue and serum levels to suppress the antimicrobial action so that the patient's defense is not overwhelmed. So cefazolin is the drug of choice for most of the procedures, and the drug which is the dose which is suggested is 1 to 2 grams. It is said that if the patient is less than 80 kgs, then 1 gram of cefazolin should be given, and if he or she is 80 to 100, 120 kgs, then 2 grams of cefazolin should be given. And for obese patients more than 120 kg, 3 grams of cefazolin should be given. In patients requiring aminoglycosides, if we take an example of gentamicin, then single dose is better than multiple small doses. So for gentamicin, say 4.5 milligram per kg dose, single dose is better than 3 doses of 1.5 milligram per kg. And in obese patients who weigh more than 20% of their ideal body weight, the dose calculation is done as per the formula of the weight which is taken for calculating the dose is ideal body weight plus 40% of the body weight, the present body weight minus the difference of present body weight and the ideal body weight. And for pediatric patients above 1 year, the dose calculation is similar as per the weight of the patient, and all the principles are similar to the adult patients, but the dose should never exceed the adult dose. Like at times when the patient is around 35-36 kg, then the dose may go above the, on calculation of the dose may go above the adult dose, so it should never be more than that. Then coming to the timing of administration, so there were various studies over the years. First, initially the people studied, there were four important studies which compared pre and post incision prophylaxis. And three of them showed that there was increased chances of SSI with post-incision antimicrobial prophylaxis. The meta-analysis of these four suggested that 25 more infections occurred per 1,000 cases when the patients were given antimicrobial prophylaxis post-incision. But the quality of data was low because there was a lot of heterogeneity in this meta-analysis in all these four studies, but definitely the point came out that the antibiotic should be given pre-incision. Now, then came a group of studies which compared less than 120 minutes, within 120 minutes of the start of the surgery, and more than 120 minutes from the start of the surgery. So there was significantly high SSI when the antimicrobial prophylaxis was given more than 20 minutes before the start of surgery. On meta-analysis also, they found that there were 250 more SSIs per 1,000 cases when the antibiotic was given more than 120 minutes before the start of surgery. And the quality of data which was present was moderate enough to say that the antibiotic should be given within 120 minutes. Now, few other studies which compared within 60 minutes or within 1 to 2 hours or within 30 minutes or 30 to 60 minutes. But there was no much difference in all these studies, and the quality of data was also low because there was lots of heterogeneity. These all studies have been discussed in WHO global guidelines, and finally they came out with the conclusion that the antibiotics should be administered within 60 minutes of the incision. And at present we have class 2 evidence because there is no pertinent RCT which compared when should the antibiotic be given? And the group of patients who were undergoing surgery was very heterogeneous. Some were carrying out on cardiovascular cases, some were carrying out on genetic urinary cases. So we have still what we have is that the antibiotic should be given within 60 minutes, but the data doesn't hold very true in all cases. And for few antibiotics like vancomycin and fluoroquinolone, the time frame has been extended to within 120 minutes because these antibiotics are given in infusion. So they take time to be infused, and they take time to actually build a level in the body and tissues. So for these two antibiotics, it's suggested that within 120 minutes it should be infused. And these guidelines may change when we are using a tourniquet. Like in orthopedic surgeries, we often use a tourniquet for surgery to decrease the blood loss. So in that cases, the antibiotic should be given before 60 minutes. There should be no modification in the dose even when there is a renal or hepatic impairment, because most of the times it is single shot antibiotic, so it is not going to harm the kidney or the liver. Then if the antibiotic has a short T-half, which most of them have, most of the cephalosporins have, it is 2 to 3 hours. So the dose should be repeated after 3 to 4 hours, that is after two half-lives of the antibiotic. And the dose is also suggested that dose should be repeated when there is significant blood loss, which is considered to be more than 1,500 ml for an adult patient. And subsequently, we do a lot of fluid replacement. So it is suggested that the level of the antibiotics would have gone down. So you should repeat the dose in such cases. But there are no controlled trials to prove all these data. And it is all based on consensus guidelines, which is always a class 2 evidence. Now, the duration of therapy for antibiotics, it is always said that the duration should be limited. Most of the recommendations are for it should be stopped within 24 hours. That is 1 to 3 doses that should be maximum. But in cardiovascular cases and liver transplant procedures, it is suggested that it may be carried over to up to 48 hours, but not beyond that. There is no data to suggest that continuation of drains or intravascular prosthesis or intravascular catheters should be a recommendation to prolong the course of antibiotics. So in all cases, the antibiotics should be stopped within 48 hours, and in most of the cases, it should be done within 24 hours. And this is done to prevent the development of bacterial resistance. But the problem is that most of the times, these guidelines are violated. Then the route of administration, obviously, it should be intravenous. Topical antibiotics are used in some cases like ophthalmology and burns. Oral antibiotics are used for bowel preparation, that is one day before the surgery. And initially in older days, rectal antibiotics were given, but now they are not given. Then potential benefits, which I have already talked about, it is most important is prevention of consequences of surgical site infection. So in most of the operations, it will be translated into terms of decreased morbidity, decreased hospital stay, decreased cost of treatment. And in some specific benefits are there, like in total hip replacement, there is decrease in long-term morbidity. And in colonic surgery, obviously, it adds to reduction in mortality as well. But there are potential harms of antimicrobial prophylaxis. First of all, the risk of allergic reactions, so proper history and proper pre-operative testing of the antimicrobial sensitivity should always be done. The risk of contribution to antimicrobial resistance, but an increase in chances of Clostridium difficile in the post-operative period. But these all come when we do not follow the protocols. When we prolong the use of antibiotics beyond 48 hours, beyond 72 hours, then all these problems arise. And there are some specific antibiotic toxicity like aminoglycosides, renal toxicity, and erythromycin GI upset. But again, for single doses of antimicrobial prophylaxis, these are not a matter of concern at all. There are few other uses than SSI, like prevention of respiratory tract infection and urinary tract infection, which can be prevented. The prevention of endocarditis in cardiovascular cases or in patients who are undergoing other surgeries but have a valve replacement. Then topical antibiotics, which can prevent ocular and burn area infection. The treatment of anticipated infection, like in cases of transplants, and oral antibiotics for gut sterilization. The problems with AMP is that the data is mostly from trials in 1970s, 80s, and early 90s. There are very few trials which have come up in the last 10 years, and most of them are observational studies. There is lots of heterogeneity of data, so we cannot come out with solid evidence that when it should be given, how long it should be given, and what should be given. But still, what we have, it suggests that it should be administered within 60 minutes of most of the surgeries. Another problem is that in most of these trials, there was no use of placebo. Always one antibody was compared with other, or the timing was deferred, or the dosing was deferred. So the comparison is not very, very solid to establish guidelines. Again, the most of the cohorts were very variable. Other than aminoglycosides and few cephalosporins, other agents have not been studied in all these trials, and the data generated was much before the development of widespread antibiotic resistance. So what we have is very, very is to be taken with a pinch of salt. So what becomes important is we should audit all our antibiotic prophylaxis protocols. We should document the date and time of administration and the time of surgical incision in all the cases in a hospital like this. We should also document whether it was elective or an emergency surgery, the classification of surgery based on the wounds, classification of wounds like clean, contaminated, and contaminated, the justification of giving antibiotics and justification of prolonging the dose of antibiotics, and the duration of surgery, which is very important. Then we should always document the adverse reactions which have occurred to the antibiotics, like allergy and the documentation of Clostridium difficile infection in the postoperative period. And we should try to adhere to the protocols. The protocols will be discussed in the subsequent talks today itself, so I'll not go into the details of that. But adhering to the protocols is the most important part in while using antimicrobial prophylaxis and preventing the development of resistance. So that's all for today. Thank you for your attention. Any questions, I'll be happy.